So first I wish to warmly thank the organizers of this conference for the invitation, and indeed this conference is an important in part continuation, but also reinforcement for Nordic cooperation in this area of research. Let me begin my presentation by a quotation from NUTFORSK, Intergovernmental Nordic Research Funding Organization, description of NUTFORSK program on Nordic Center of Excellence in Welfare Research 2007. Combining competitiveness and growth with a high level of social services, the so-called Nordic model is attracting international attention. For example, Nordic citizens are among those who are least at risk of poverty and have the highest life expectancy in Europe. However, the Nordic model is under pressure against the backdrop of globalization, European integration, immigration, and the aging society, and increased individualization. Many have predicted the death of Nordic welfare state. There is consequently a need for research in order to assess if Nordic welfare model can renew itself in the face of global competition, 2007. At the end phase of this program and the end phase of the work of the Centers of Excellence, which we have already referred to, reassess and not well, the Nordic model still was very much alive, as we could read in Economist had many pages on the next supermodel. But why the world should look at the Nordic countries? And it may be so that the research made in the Center of Excellence program had not a kind of main factor in keeping up the model. But in any case, I guess this kind of discourse around the Nordic model gives it motivates my question, which are here: how does competition between different models precondition or frame Nordic welfare state research, and how is this competition and comparison between different models somehow included in the agendas of the Nordic welfare state research? I have no final answers. I wish to raise these questions concerning the discussion on models and more widely discussion around the need of comparative research, and also some problems in comparative welfare state research. We can say that this very concept of models, it emerged in the 1980s, somehow reflecting encounters between national institutions and globalized capitalism. Increased interest in varieties of capitalism in general, welfare capitalism, in research, rise of institutionalism, including historical institutionalism. One can say that in politics, economies, and cultures, increased comparative reflexivity took place, importance of comparisons as a part of politics and economies. And this kind of comparative reflexivity was facilitated and also encouraged by international organizations, including OECD. All in all, new or reinforced rivalry between different national institutional settings called models in globalized capitalism and in the context of European integration. And we have learned a lot from research focusing on comparisons between different welfare state models at different levels. New research results concerning the differences between different welfare and similarities at a kind of regime level, at the level of politics concerning the actors and struggles shaping and making the welfare state, or concerning the policies, meaning this kind of ways in which the welfare systems, welfare states are functioning. And also new research results, interesting ongoing projects and studies on life courses, meaning how welfare state practices and people's everyday life are meeting each other, what kind of different modes of social citizenship, for example, are developed in these encounters. Very successful research. But at the same time, what I would like to also take up is a risk and kind of also, one could say, characteristic of methodological nationalism in much of model comparisons and comparative welfare state research. One is focusing on similarities and differences of national institutions. One is focusing on convergence and divergence of national trajectories. Okay, it results in important results and interesting new problems. In any case, there is this tendency of having these national societies as a self-evident, taken for granted units of analysis. Since Esping Andersson, we talk about three worlds of welfare capitals, or perhaps more than three worlds of welfare capitals. But in any case, worlds here are clusters of national societies. Sometimes comparisons may just focus on isolated national units, when societies are seen as containers within the borders of the nation state. In a more developed comparative setting, comparisons are focusing on national adaptations to global economy. But there's all again some problems which are described. For example, Saskia Sassen, who talks about the state adaptability scholarship, in which researchers tend to see the global as external and national as internal, and this kind of division is taken for granted. History is I guess very often in studies in the framework of historical institutionalism. History is a synonymous for national specificities or origins of national specificities or path dependencies keeping up national specificities. And so somehow I think one should try to find ways beyond methodological nationalism, while at the same time taking very seriously that national societies, nation states, the ways in which they are functioning are an important topic of research. Somehow trying to find ways of examining the shaping of and reshaping of nation states and national political actors' agendas as an integral part of transnational transformations, global transformations, and thus as an important topic of research. So, an approach I would like to somehow develop is seeing national welfare states as transnational historical constructions, so that global is not just somewhere outside of the national society, but it's somehow within the national. Transnational economic, political, and cultural processes were very integral, kind of constitutive of the making of national welfare states. And in the processes we call globalization, globalization does not just happen in the external environment of national entities, but very much within and also through nation-centered modes of thought and action. Also this division between global and external and national internal somehow has its own history. It's not a kind of taken for granted. Seeing that comparisons and histories, they are not something that only something that we researchers are doing. It's not only us who are comparing and drawing from historical experiences, but there are also parts of politics and economies, and taking this kind of aspect in politics and the making and shaping of the welfare state seriously. The role of the Nordic transnational framework in the development of the Nordic national welfare state is one. Interesting issue in that context, how this transnational, cross-national Nordic framework has actually played an important role in the development of national identities and national institutions, and also in consciousness of national differences in five Nordic countries. So this somehow this idea which we in these centers of excellence program conferences very often used to, we had almost a kind of jargon of talking about one model with five exceptions in the Nordic countries. So still some words, if I have time, about these narratives. Helena Blomback in her opening speech already talked about the role of narratives in for welfare state research. I think some narratives, historical and comparative narratives around the concept of model have also been important, are somehow important for research and should be taken critically into account. There are some ambiguities in discourses or ways of using the expression of the Nordic model. When one discusses in partly in scholarly text, but mostly in media and the political debates, in debates on different models, the concept of model seems to, on one hand, refer to persistent cultural norms and values which give rise to different kinds of welfare policies and issues. This is a way of using the concept of model. But at the same time, concept of model is in the use in which refers to very, very rapidly transferable knowledge about best practices that can be utilized in cross-border policy learning, international policy learning. For example, way of using the concept of model when one discusses the possibilities to export ingredients of the Nordic model or the whole Nordic model in some other parts of the world, be it for East Asia or China. In welfare research, we meet this tension between two models in discussion. On one hand, in emphasis on path dependencies, on the other hand, in emphasis on convergence. Another second alternative, second ambiguity in usages of the Nordic model can be seen in how the specificities of the Nordic model are characterized. They are pretty often kind of way of seeing the Nordic model as a uniquely consistent representative of what I've seen as universal trajectory of social progress and reform. For example, Marcus W. Schultz, to which Björn referred to, very much saw the Scandinavian, especially Sweden, as a unique representative of something that is universal in progress. But then there is another way of talking about the specificities of the Nordic welfare states and the Nordic model. It's kind of emphasis on what is it is expressed in so-called bumblebee argument, that Nordic model is a paradoxical mode of combining principles and practices that are at first sight incompatible. bumblebee shouldn't fly, but it does, so that in the Nordic countries, high taxation and economic competitiveness at the same time, or the strong state and the strong individual at the same time, finding paradoxes. In welfare state research, one can see this kind of dualism in ways in which, on one hand, Nordic welfare states are examined as cases for exploring cases when one has this research interest in some kind of universal modernization, or then the Nordic welfare state are seen as exceptions which require particular explanations. And then coming to still more recent and current discussions, in assessment of national adaptations to globalized capitalism or European integration, Nordic model is also discussed in, or this usage of model is dualistic in the sense that very often it's Nordic model is seen as a target of external challenges, but often also as a response to external challenges. And here we come to what could be seen also a discussion in research on the relationship between the welfare state and competition state, welfare and competitiveness in the Nordic model. And in any case, Nordic welfare state is very popular at the same time. Strong popular support for the welfare state in all Nordic countries. And those who are concerned about economic competitiveness or government budget discipline or sustainability gap, they motivate these concepts, these concerns by necessity to rescue the welfare state. Rescuing the welfare state as motivation. And so do also those who are building up different threat images, xenophobic threat images based on cross-border mobility and immigration. And again, those who are defending the Nordic welfare state, the first kind of preference, they are developing arguments that point out that Nordic welfare states are actually no burdens, but they generate competitive advantages. So that rescuing the welfare state is a goal that sanctifies many different means, but also seems to be a means that sanctifies many different goals. And last point is that this kind of popularity of the welfare state may be a little bit problematic also in ways in which we discuss the role of the welfare state in societies and which we use the concept of social, one can see a kind of dualism, which I would say kind of post-welfare state and pre-welfare state meanings of social. On one hand, welfare state is seen to provide social preconditions for innovative, competitive economy and society. Concepts as social capital, social investment, risk sharing are somehow concepts in ways of developing motivations and arguments for a welfare state as a productive factor or some a competitive advantage in economy. On the other hand, welfare state is discussed as institutions and practices dealing with problems of social exclusion and social order, including problems associated with immigration, concepts like social cohesion or activation and security are usually here. I would argue that welfare state institutions are modified to fulfill competition state and security state functions in the world of cross-border mobilities of money, information, jobs, and people. And when looking at the achievements of the Nordic welfare states, we can see that there's incremental but not dramatic changes have taken place in institutional appearances of the Nordic model, and incremental but not dramatic changes have taken and are taking place in redistributive outcomes of the Nordic welfare state and the Nordic welfare model. But then there still is an important issue of limits of nation-state perspectives in defining problems and solutions, and especially in attempts to combine objectives and of social and economic and ecological sustainability. And these new challenges are somehow, I would say that they are challenges to a very deep-rooted Nordic modal thought in which different kinds of virtuous circles within a national society are emphasized and made as a framework of welfare state development. Thank you.